Welcome to Movies, Films, and Flicks. I am Mark Hoffmeyer, and joining me is someone who's going to be playing really mellow piano music during this entire recording. It's Anande Buetis. Just over the whole thing. Just beautiful Philip Glass music during this entire recording.
I love that. Give me like a simple piano arrangement with this beautiful, simple melody. I'm in. I'm here for it. Love it.
So there's a show on Amazon Prime that I watched this year called Tales from the Loop. It's a very mellow, thoughtful, neat show, which I love the cinematography. I love the lighting, but I also really dug the score. And during the research of this for Candyman 1992, I looked up Philip Glass, and I realized that he helped out on the score for The Truman Show, which he did the Truman Sleeps piece, which is beautiful. And then he also did the Tales from the Loop soundtrack. And I love that soundtrack. So I just got real excited. I yelled up to my wife, Megan. I'm like, Megan, Philip Glass did Tales from the Loop. And she's like, cool.
That's nice, honey.
Yeah, but that's how nerdy I got into this research here for Candyman. And I'm so glad that this is going to be random, but I'm so glad that you recommended doing Candyman 1992, because I started looking up the people who did all the special effects on this movie, the special effects, the makeup, the prosthetics. And you have some insane people. So you have Marc Coulier. He won 2 Oscars for Iron Lady and Grand Budapest Hotel. But what I realized was between Leonard Pollack and Bob and Dave Keane, Gary Tunnicliffe, and Marc Coulier, they all basically got their start on Waxwork. And then they worked on either Nightbreed or those early kind of Clive Barker films. So they, in 88, they all worked together and then they went on their own. I know the Keens and Coulier worked on Event Horizon. They did the hell scenes, the really gnarly visions of hell.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But I love it that, like, they got their start there. And what, like that Marc Coulier, he worked on Nightbreed, Event Horizon, AVP. Sunshine, and then you did Pride and Prejudice and Zombies. I knew you'd like that, because, I don't know, that's a fun movie. It's a good zombie pick film. And then...
Pride and Prejudice and Zombies. Yeah, that was excellent.
Oh, I love that movie. But what made me most happy was this Gary Tunnicliffe, who did the blood in this movie. He worked on Gone Girl. He was the blood guy in Gone Girl when she gets covered in blood.
Well, that was... I mean, that was pretty good.
Yeah.
That was done pretty well.
She wiped out MPH, and that was him. And if you watch Candyman, the blood in this movie is exceptional. I mean,
it's something. Just the splattering in general, like on the walls and stuff. I mean, like a lot of times the sets are pretty much covered in it, but if you look closer, you'll see it's splattering, almost like paint, like splattered against the walls. It's amazing.
It's so deep red too, and gooey and thick and like coagulated in certain moments.
Ugh. It's like the first time when Helen wakes up in that pool of blood in Anne-Marie's apartment. Like that, just that pool of blood. Ugh.
It's good blood work in this movie. And when Trevor at the end, when he's all, it's a different color than the other blood because it's more recent. It's insane.
Oh, yeah.
I actually love all the red that... So I got excited. I shouldn't have done this, but I messaged you on Twitter while I was watching this movie. And you probably shouldn't do that. You should probably save it for the podcast. But I love how she wears red. Her car's red. Then you have the deep blood red. But then the rest of the colors are kind of muted. Like every light in this movie looks like it's on a dimmer and it's very warm. And the oranges aren't bright orange. They're more of like a toasted orange. The colors in this... I like how you get the deep red, the bright red, but then everything else is muted, and the light is muted as well. It's warm, and I think that gives it such a neat vibe. Like I don't know, this movie, it's really good, Candyman. It's not just a horror movie. I think it's a good film in general.
Absolutely. Like, you know, the first time they're at Cabrini Green, and the first time they enter Anne-Marie's apartment, and it immediately strikes you, like, even before we step into the apartment, the door opens and we already see, like, you know, a part of the apartment, and you can see that soft pinks of the wall. So on the outside, you've got like these like a dark muted, like reddish brownish colors with green and stuff, but like you say, pretty much muted. And then this light pink that immediately hits you. And then, you know, in the end where Helen goes back home after she escaped the hospital where she was, and she walks in, and yeah, the the lover is painting a apartment this bright pink. So that's also pretty nice, you know, like Anne-Marie's apartment with the soft pinks and stuff, showing like how she's, you know, like also just a person living there, trying to make do, trying to look after a child. Even though like from the outside, you can judge and say like, it looks freaking terrible and these people don't care and whatever. Versus then at the end, that old thing where the girlfriend thinks this is the color that you use to make a home, but it's this bright pink and it looks like Helen wants to die from freaking, why is my apartment this bright Barbie doll pink?
Yeah.
I love that, where she walks in and she's just like, you can just see her whole demeanor is like, oh no, what am I looking at?
Man, Trevor, too, he gets sick of her quick too, that poor lady. His new girlfriend. By the end, he's just sitting in the bathroom, like, oh man, I'm already over Stacey. It's interesting.
Trevor is the worst, Mark. Trevor, like every time I watch, I can't decide. Honestly, we should do a poll when we air this episode. Like, who's the worst, Trevor or Professor Pascal?
Oh,
like, honestly, who's the worst man in this movie?
Just speaking, you feel so bad for Helen Lyle in this, played by Virginia Madsen. Also, I think Bernard Rose kind of loved, this is weird, but sometimes you watch a movie and you're like, this director really likes this actor, this actress's face. But the way he lights her, and I know that was purposeful, like with her eyes being lit in certain moments and the hypnotizing, but just the light on her hair, the way it glows a little bit, the way he frames her in a lot of shots with almost like really sort of like angelic soft lighting. But then watching all the crap she goes through with her husband, talking about urban legends before she can release her paper, and messing with the undergrads, and then this guy mansplaining something she's researching. It's a really interesting mix, though, how Bernard Rose lights her and frames her, but then the way people treat her in the story. It's a really neat kind of split, I guess, between that. And I don't know if you noticed
absolutely. That. No, absolutely. And I think because, you know, as much as there's like, there's a very strong like racism theme in Candyman, but there's also a very strong theme of women and how, you know, women in peril is used to demonize the black man type of thing. And, but the focus is like very much on her, like how she also gets treated and like almost no one takes her seriously because this is all power play thing going on in the film all the time, where it's kind of like, it feels like they're suggesting you have to put the fear of God in people for them to respect you, you know, because that's kind of like Candyman's thing. And that's kind of what happens with Helen, you know, like Trevor only takes her seriously when she supposedly starts going berserk, you know. It's this all power thing. So yeah, watching like the men, but I love that restaurant scene where, even though I want to punch Purcell, Professor Purcell, in the face when he's like, I wrote about him 10 years ago. Like, I hate that. Like, don't you just want to... Anyway, and then he goes into this whole, so, the legend of Candyman, with his freaking drawl accent. Look, he does it. The actor does it really, really well. What's his name again?
The actor, let me... I have...
I've got him here somewhere. Michael Culkin.
Philip Purcell.
I don't really know much about him, but I thought he did like the insufferable mansplaining professor pretty well. You know, he's telling this story, and that shot that Bernard Rose does it's almost like Hitchcockian also, but like this romantic goth with like the lights only covering like it's a mask over her face. I get so excited. I like lose my words.
A lot is asked of Virginia Madsen in this. She has to react to that story. And to be fair, she just has a camera in her face and maybe Culkin's reading off screen, but just the way she reacts to it, this like the way she absorbs it with almost like empathy, and she's into it, learning it.
Yeah, definitely empathy, because like that's what I love about the scene, which is what I tried to get to, is like he's like being all academic about it and let me tell you about the history, and also kind of embellishing it because he's just loving being able to everyone shut up and listen to my story kind of vibe. But then like her reaction to it, and like how she goes in this entrancement with the the fear, but also the fascination. And then you can see just the sadness in her eyes of what in the hell? This is the saddest story. How can people be so terrible? Mm-hmm. Like, it's so that bit of acting with her. Like, she's very good in this movie. She's got moments where it's like, girl, no wonder she won a lot of critic awards and stuff for this one. Like, and you can see why. She was really good at it.
Her computer acting and her microfish screen acting.
You messaged me about that as well.
Yeah, I'm obsessed with computer acting in movies because...
Oh, really?
It's not easy. You're staring at a blue screen, green screen, but just the way that they shot her is just her... I don't know, there's like a sense of wonder as she's researching on the computer, typing in. I've never seen computer acting like hers before. It's not...
It's a lot of close-ups in the film of her. A lot of close-ups. I mean, up and close and personal.
Bernard Lowe, he likes shooting her face. That sounds weird, but you can tell. Like, I was watching Frances Ha, right? And Greta Gerwig is in that movie, and Alexander Payne directed? No, Noah Baumbach directed that, Frances Ha. Mm-hmm. And I kept saying, like, I feel like this dude is really into Greta. Like, I don't know. I'm not trying to be reductive or anything. And they do this with, like, both people. But the way that he shot, Noah Baumbach shot Greta Gerwig, I'm like, man, he likes her. And then a year or two later, they're together. Like, I don't know if that works every time or if you've noticed that, but sometimes you're like, geez Louise, this is going there. But she holds it really well. And I think about her or either Sandra Bullock, and Sandra Bullock's a fine actress, but I liked her sense of wonder in this. Like, and I liked that she was a different character too. She really goes against the typical, this movie actually goes against most of the horror vibes that you can think of. You have the romantic villain who's, he's trying to...
Exactly. Anti-hero.
Yeah, in Demon Knight, you have Billy Zane trying to... This is a weird example, but you have Billy Zane as an evil entity trying to seduce people to his side. And then this one, he's trying to seduce Helen. And I think that's a really interesting vibe. He's not just trying to kill her. Then you have her where she gets a black eye, but she goes back and she's not afraid. She seems... industrious. It's a really interesting take, and she loved it too, because she's like, normally, like, the traditional role was always helpless victims, but now Alien and Halloween, she's like, where women get chased but still remain strong. So she's like, Helen never allows herself to be a victim in Candyman. Horrible things happen to her, but she fights back. And that's really rare nowadays. I don't know, it's cool. It's a good movie.
Is. I mean, there's a reason it's got a cult following and it's getting a remake and everything, because there's a lot of stuff. And I think a lot of people are like, yeah, but the movie still could have pushed it. And like, there's, you know, stuff wrong with it. But I mean, this was 1992. Have you seen the horror movies from 1992?
Like, I actually have that list pulled up.
1992. Yeah, there we go. For 1992, this was really good. I mean... You know, I've seen, this is not my idea, I've seen people say it before, but there's also a lot of similarities that you can draw between Candyman and Get Out, for instance, you know, a lot of stuff. So if you think then, you know, or remember then that this was back in 1992, like it was different stuff that we were being shown. Like, I love the fact that Candyman was, you know, like not, like I read somewhere, I don't know if it was Bernard Rose or Tony Todd that said he was a tragic hero, so he had more to in common with Dracula than with Freddy Krueger, for instance, you know.
Ooh.
Having like the black man and his like you know, like sufferings and like his whole the mythology that happened, but because of how he was treated in life, and then the white woman and her same stuff, even though like it's different classes, but then making these classes clash within the movie. Man, like, I remember when I watched this, I was like I think I was 10, 11, like I was young.
Yeah.
But I was like, what did I just watch? And it stuck with me. Like, it was so good. I wanted to watch it again because I couldn't understand anything, because I was still like, not anything. I couldn't understand all of the things because I was young. But it had such an impression because, you know, having watched all the other horror movies and stuff, it was so different. It was just, but it also resonated because you felt with both Helen and Candyman, you know?